Hello, hello, and how is everyone doing this evening? I hope you're doing well. Sorry, I'm a bit late coming on here. Well, I had to take care of, because, you know, before anything, I'm a mother, mother of two sons. So the sons need looking after. Well, one of them was hungry and wanted me to get some food. So yes, I had to take care of that before coming on the stream. So yeah, pardon me for coming late. I've got to be a mommy first. Please let me know if you can hear me okay. Right? Hey, hello, Randolph. I see here we've got Randolph. Hello. We've got Indy. Hello, Indy. Hello, guys. I hope you're doing okay. So because I've started late, I'm going to get started quick. Just, you know, we're not going to waste any time. That's a lovely photo you've got there, Indy. Oh, that's nice. Oh, which one of you is, which one of those two people is Indy? On the left or on the right? So kids always, yes, that's right, Indy. I completely agree. Completely agree. So, guys, I live in the UK, and UK may not have so much of a problem with religion. No, not so much, because I would consider the UK, they're more secular than, trust me, there is religion. The church is still a very huge part of the decision making. They still have the House of Lords, where some people from the church have to be in the House of Lords. So they're really, the separation of church and state, they're a long way there, but they're not quite there. They're still some things, and organizations like the Humanists UK, which I'm a part of, they are fighting to have the government completely free of any form of religion. Why should you have people who are from the church in the House of Lords? How does that work? So that's a conversation but so far, so good. They're in a much better position, in my opinion. But hey, Theo, good to see you. I'm the one on the right. The left one is singer Amethyst Kia. Oh, okay. Ah, I don't know Amethyst. So did you say Amethyst? Amethyst, that's a special name to me. So I need to go check that one out. Yes. Theoretically, good to see you here. How are you getting on with your studies, Theo? You finished? Theo, tell us the good news. Have we finished? Have we finished now, Theo? Are we going to be graduating soon? Are we? Yeah, Theo, come on. Tell me. Very beautiful voice. Oh, yes. Oh, I bet she has a beautiful voice. Okay, let's get started. So, as much as the UK is a very secular place, we still have problems with people who somehow they think they've got this religion and that their religion can somehow solve all of the world's problems. So this man relocated from Nigeria to the UK and set up church, right? And now he's becoming a nuisance. In my opinion, he's becoming a nuisance to the UK society. So what you're going to see is one of the pastors in this man's church. So let's get started, and you will understand why. Three more semesters. It's going to go very quick, Theo. Very quick. It's going to just don't rush me. Hurry up. We need to get you making all this money. Come on. Come on, Theo. Okay. Right. Let me share my screen here. So how's everyone doing? I hope you're doing well. And please tell me, what time is it where you are? Here it is nearly 6 p.m. It's 5:48 p.m. So what time is it where you are? Okay, where's this picture? Let's see the picture. Anyway, the lady who we're going to be talking about, her name is Mariam. She's now known as Mariam Mbula. She was once known as Mariam Mola. Her name changes from time to time because she's a criminal, but also she's a pastor. So the victims who were taken in by the serial con artist who won hearts with the story of how she changed her life. This lady came out with this grand story. I was in jail. I gave birth to my baby in jail. And my life, I turned my life around. And now I'm running all these businesses. I'm mentoring young girls. What it was, as part of the church, the pastor had put her in charge of young girls. They were doing this community living, and Mariam Mola was put as the leader of these girls. These young girls, this was all a church. This church encouraged communal living, and all these girls were made to go to work, and while they were at work, they come back, all their monies go to Mariam. And then Mariam passes this money on to the pastor Toby. So, okay, let's just. So she gave this story about how she changed her life after giving birth in prison and reveals she was left hunting for pennies under the sofa to buy food while another lost 100,000. These are the people who she conned. So Mariam Mbula, who often goes by the name Mariam Mola, has appeared on TV shows, and she was hailed as a success story who turned her life around after she was jailed for fraud, age 18. But last year, that was in 2020, it was revealed that the 30-year-old Londoner has at least 13 convictions for 34 offences, 27 of those for fraud and dishonesty, and had been jailed in the UK, jailed in Belgium, and jailed in Spain. So this lady, after doing all of this, turns up in church, and the pastor of the church says, I'm going to make you a pastor. So this is Mariam. She was also wanted for leading a crime gang in Italy, which targeted luxury boutiques with fraudulent credit cards. So that's Mariam there. That was her on the Lorraine show. I wouldn't be playing this video because it's the BBC and you know what those people are like. So yes, that's Mariam. We will now go and watch a video. Let's see here. Hey, Parilla Time, Brian Stevens, hello. Good to see you. Who else do we have? Blue, hello, Blue. Good to see you. So let's see, what time is it where you are? Oh, you're in the Netherlands. It's 1 hour ahead, 6:48 p.m. Oh, nearly seven. Blue says it's 12:48 a.m. in the Eastern North America. How nice. Hey, Parilla Time. Hello, all of my beautiful people. Good to see you. Randolph. Hello, Randolph. Yes. Okay. Hey, Black Poodle. Black Poodle, how are you? Okay, now let's So this
assalamu alaikum. If you're in a position where you want to leave your 9-to-5 job and have more money,
what assalamu alaikum?
only have, I would say, roughly 4 to 5 hours left before, you know, you can't register to vote. So please, if you are watching this video, the link is attached below in my video. Please register to vote. Just click that link if you have not taken. Register to vote. Mirage underscore Morali. Subscribe. Now, I obviously wanted to do a kind of documentary related kind of analysis video of really just finding out who this Mariam Mola individual person is. Of course, a lot of people have been talking about it, discussing, making videos. Of course, the channel Exposer, which everybody knows about, who is doing an absolutely great job in really detailing what is going on with SPAC Nation, with, you know, the actually underlayers of this whole institution, corrupt institution, I might add, which I definitely feel like it is, allegedly, but still, I feel like it definitely is. Where we have Mariam Mola, who somebody, you know, there was a video that I did a while ago on her when she was with Gifty, and the way she just seemed to be very controlling, she seemed to be somebody who can adopt the behavior of a handler very easily. And I wouldn't be surprised if she was a handler of so many young individuals and people. But I thought I would do like kind of like a background research to find out who really is this person, who is Mariam Mola, and just really go through everything and just the background, because it's all literally online in terms of the newspapers, the articles, the Telegraph, like the Guardian. Everybody has reported on this in the past. So, you know, this is public information, and this public information seems to be very shocking.
Own your space, stay in your lane, and do what works for you, and build gradually.
I don't care how I get it. I just know that I can get it. And even if I don't get it, it will come through. God will show me who has the money.
Own your space, stay in your lane, and do what works for you, and build gradually. It has to have a purpose. There has to be an assignment behind why you're using certain platforms.
I need 7 people that can give me 1K every week. I don't want you paying for services anymore. I'm going to find those. And I said, is that okay? Because I know that you were paying for services before. I don't want you paying for services anymore. I can't rely on one person to give me money for services. I don't even need that.
Fill your space. I would never try and get an audience full of makeup artists to meet me up for breakfast in that morning. They wouldn't come because I don't know anything about makeup.
Know your space.
It has to have a purpose. There has to be an assignment behind why you're using certain platforms. Own your space. Stay in your...
So this lady, with all of her criminal convictions, turns up in a church. The church decided that we'll make you a pastor. She didn't go through any training. She didn't go through any, no form of formal training to become a pastor. Nothing. Just made her a pastor, made her a mentor of young people, and just put her in a place and said, you all start living together. These young ladies thought, oh, we've got a mentor. We've got this, because she started putting out her social media things, making herself look so grand and, you know, wearing all the designer gear. But she has a criminal past. And here we are allowing this young girl, young lady, woman, to tell the people she's talking to. They're between the ages of 14, 15, to I think the late 20s. Young London black people. She's telling them. She wants these young people to give her £1,000 every week. No, every month or every week. I didn't even hear it again. So that they can, because this church, they don't have a place of their own. They don't have a place where they gather. Every time they gather, they would rent hotel rooms. Conference rooms in a hotel. And they didn't go for the cheap hotels. They went for the expensive hotels in London. Because they were trying to paint a picture that they were rich people. They were, you know, doing... The pastor always wears designer gear. He's always... I've done a few streams on this man. A few videos on him. The designer pastor. And so they put out this picture that they're thriving and doing so well, when in fact the money, they're getting this money from the youngsters in this ministry. These children, they believe in God. And someone just comes along and says, oh, give, sow seed, just give. So they, in their minds, think that they're giving to God. 1K, she needs 7 people to give her 1K every week or every month.
Lane and do what works for you and build gradually. It has to have a purpose. There has to be an assignment behind why you're using certain platforms.
I just want to reiterate the seriousness of this video as well. It's nothing to laugh about. I think there's no form of tea or, you know, joy or, you know, kind of just like a banter about this entire video. I feel like it's very serious. And I feel like we should definitely just take it with that tone. For example, I was obviously looking through several articles and one of them was the Daily Telegraph, which can disclose that Miss Mola's claim.
Parilla time. Well said. Those two things have already happened. Financial abuse. The church has been shut down for failure to declare the correct papers. The tax man went in there to go do audits and they didn't quite pass. And they could not explain where the monies went. 1 point something million pounds. Just, phew, they could not explain. The church has been shut down. But guess what? They changed their name, they rebranded, and they're back open again. They're now called the Nation Family. Now, there have been allegations of sexual abuse in this communal living thing that they've been doing. But recently, they've gone quiet. But you're quite right. Those things have already happened. They've already been exposed.
Names are not all they appear to be. In fact, her real name is Mariam Mbula, who on one occasion preyed on a woman with a Down syndrome's daughter in order to trick her family out of more than £15,000 by posing as a foreign official. Mbula also used other pseudonyms, including Cindy Mbula, far from being an innocent 18-year-old caught up in a single crime perpetrated by a much older boyfriend. Now,
so Mariam Mola, also known as Mariam Mbula, she was in jail, guys. Listen to this. This pastor who you're looking at was in jail. And she befriended someone in jail, and another lady. And, you know, got really close, found out information about this lady's family. And then Mariam, she gets out. When Mariam gets out, she contacts the family of that friend who she befriended in jail and told them, look, I've got a good lawyer who can help you. Your mom gets out quick. And these young ladies, right, the daughters of this woman who was jailed in a different country, her daughters were here in the UK, and they want their mom back. They said, yes, help us, anything to do to help us. And Mariam, you know, conned these girls out of, he just said, £15,000. Turned out there was no lawyer, there was no one help, nothing, there was nothing. She conned these young girls. There's a documentary done by the BBC. It's online. It's called Catch Her If You Can. They did a complete expose in interviewing all the people that she has conned.
Now, before I continue to read this article, that's just the one sentence that I'm going to read over again to you guys. Far from being an innocent 18-year-old caught up in a single crime perpetrated by a much older boyfriend. Now, we're going to cast it a few years back to an interview that she did on the Lorraine show. And if you actually just watch
this video, Christopher Bacon, good to see you. Clips,
of her behavior and her body language. That's what I want you to concentrate on. But I'm not going to concentrate on what she is saying here, because I do believe that is a complete bravado. But if you actually listen and study the body language of this individual and this person, then you can see that there seems to be this form of decorum, a complete different behavior, even the way she speaks, if you want to focus on that, just everything. If you channel all of that behavior and actually try to study it, it's very different to what we've seen in the, you know, SPAC Nation related pasta kind of videos that she does online and these kind of live calls and whatever, this FaceTime stuff. It's very, very different.
And, the person I was with committed some fraud, and because I was involved in that crowd, I was later sentenced to quite a heavy prison sentence when expecting my first baby.
It's a completely different persona she's adopted and played upon, and I find this to be very interesting, and it only highlights the in-depth of kind of fraudulent mindset of this individual and how scary it can be when it comes to, you know, just brainwashing younger children to take out loans, etc.
So now this is the question I'm going to ask. The people who get recruited in church to become preachers, pastors, reverend fathers, whatever titles they give these people, who does checks on their past? Who verifies if they have been, you know, if they're not criminally minded, if they're not... Now, don't get me wrong, guys. I believe that people can reform. You can, you know, people can change. People can, you know, they can be better and do better. I strongly believe that. But you've got to be careful, especially when you're dealing with young people or just anyone, whether young, old, whoever. You have someone who has 27 convictions before joining you. And instead of starting small with her, you immediately put her in the helm of things. Make her pastor. She now became the one in charge of raising funds for the church. Who gets to check these people? Who gets to do, like, you know, when you about some, there's some jobs before you start, they do like a criminal background check on you. Do churches do these things? Because anybody can just go into a church and just be anything. And that's where you get cases of people, you know, young kids being abused, because nobody does their checks. And even when they do the checks and do find out what the person has done, oh, but because these religions teach that, God has forgiven them. Oh, he's a merciful God. God has wiped the slate clean. So they're okay. So let's just... So I guess even if they do the checks, it doesn't matter, because God has forgiven them. So everyone, off we go. Let's just get them in. Crazy.
And how scary it can be. And, you know, there seems to be an entire different person. She's playing the narrative of how she was tricked as a young girl, naive, somebody much more older. She was at the wrong place at the wrong time. This is the narrative that she's been going with. I was at the wrong place at the wrong time. I've had a baby during prison. Woe me, woe me, woe me. I'm going to use
that's
this
right,
to show how
time.
Strong I am and how I've overcome stuff. Then I'm going to use that narrative to help manipulate people and brainwash them without them even knowing it by using a very simple term called gaslighting, which I feel like something that she's definitely been doing with these people. That video gifty was just very sad to see.
I think it's a great idea. House sitters get somewhere to stay, and we, the house owners, get someone to look after.
Mbula was a career con artist, the Daily Telegraph reports, who had been jailed not only in the UK, but also in Belgium and Spain. She was also wanted on suspicion of leading a crime gang in Italy. In total, Mbula has at least 13 convictions for 34 offences. 27 of those are for fraud and dishonesty, according to Detective Sergeant David Vint of the Metropolitan Police, who has investigated her for 18 months. Mariam Mola from East London most recently received a 24-month suspended sentence at Southwark Crown Court on July the 1st this year. She pleaded guilty to 3 counts of fraud following her arrest in November 2014. The court heard that on July 17, 2013, Mbula had dishonestly made a false representation claiming to be an official from the British consulate in Spain. She had been jailed in Spain for fraud and whilst in prison befriended her cellmate, a British woman, with 2 daughters in the UK, one of whom who has Down syndrome. Mbula was freed before her cellmate and then contacted the family in Britain, posing as an embassy official. She telephoned one of the daughters official. And explained that because her sister had Down syndrome.
Okay, so it turns out she had... I thought she was pretending to be... Well, she tried to tell them she had a lawyer. No, it turns out she was pretending to be an embassy official. She conned this person, one who she had met in jail, conned her daughters here in the UK. This lady is just
pure evil. Her mother was eligible for early release. All she had to do was deposit £15,600 in a bank account as sure and the mother would be released. It was, of course, a scam. Then in August 2014, Mbula was at it again. This time, she claimed to be working with Nike, the sportswear company. She told her victim that she could make the woman's daughter the global face of the brand. The victim duly handed over £11,000.
Wow. Telling people that I will make your daughter the face of the brand Nike. And that woman hands over £11,000. All is scam. All is scam.
£11,400. A few months later, on November 24, 2014, Mbula again conned her victim out of £18,214.06 by selling her numerous designer clothes, which she never delivered. A further set of alleged offences were allowed to remain on file, including swindling a number of women over a designer shoe business called Cindy Shoes, which she set up in 2014. One victim, Natasha Bendel, 32, mother of three, told The Telegraph how Mbula, going by the name of Cindy, had taken more than £655 from her for Christian Louboutin shoes that she had hoped to wear.
Hey, Baron, hello.
The shoes never arrived. Mbula and Mariam Mola vanished with the money in June 2014. She's a total crook, says Mrs. Brendel from Reading. Mrs. Bendel was staggered to see Mbula appear on daytime television using the name Mariam Mola, describing how she had turned her life around after giving birth in jail in May 2015. Mbula told an interview Gabby Rosalind, who presents ITV's Lorraine, that she had been caught up in a fraud committed by a former partner almost a decade ago. I was in a bad relationship at the time, Mbula told Rosalind. And the person I was with committed some fraud, and because I was involved in that crowd, I was later sentenced to quite a heavy prison sentence when expecting my first baby. It is a claim she's repeated in newspapers and also a lot of series of Mentor Macho events. There's no suggestion of any wrongdoing by Mentor Macho. Another victim, Shamina Dixon, this is ridiculous, 29, was also astonished by the claims. Mbula has stolen £1,600 from her mother, promising to buy a cheap flight to Jamaica to visit Miss Dixon's sick grandmother. Mbula took the money, but the airline tickets never materialized. This is ridiculous.
This is a fast.
Mbula did give birth in a UK prison after being jailed in May 2015 at Basildon Crown Court. Mm-hmm. She had been arrested in February the previous year by Essex police for a series of credit and bank card frauds committed between March 2010 and June 2011. It had taken time for police to catch up with her because she was serving prison sentences in Spain and Belgium prior to her arrest and her return to the UK. Mbula, when approached by The Telegraph at the Bulgaria hotel event yesterday, declined to comment. She'd also failed to respond to emails for comments. This is clearly to be, you know, shocking. It's upsetting. It's disgusting. I find it to be very sad. We have this individual who, you know, there are multiple accounts. There are several accounts of fraud, conned, you know, kind of crimes that have taken place. So the question that comes to my head immediately is, why would Spac Nation employ somebody to work at their church, their institution,
good question,
who has this many accounts on their file?
Good question.
That in itself, the fact that she even works with them and represents them, within itself even highlights how corrupt this institution can definitely be. Because no church institution is working with young children, young boys, young girls, naive young individuals and people should have somebody like this around them in their environment, because they're going to pose a danger to them.
Own your space, stay in your lane and do what works for you and build gradually.
I don't care how I get it. I just know that I can get it. And even if I don't get it, it will come through. God will show me who has the money. I was speaking to Pastor Arthur this week. I said, I need 7 people that can give me 1K every week. I don't want you paying for services anymore. I'm going to find those. And I said, is that okay? Because I know that you were paying for services before. I don't want you paying for services anymore. I can't rely on one person to give me money for services. I don't even need that.
Maybe not physical, but definitely either financial, which we've definitely read out and seen, and definitely mentally as well. And I find it to be shocking. The fact that she's even within the circumference of this church in itself speaks volumes. Yes, people can change, they can be employed, and you know they can work, and everybody should be given a chance. But I haven't read out one or two accounts to you. I've read out several, 5 to 6 to 7 to 8. So many accounts of continuous fraudulent crimes of the past that have taken place, where she seems to put on this entire bravado, and it's shocking. And the reason why I'm doing this video, and the reason why I'm discussing this, talking to you about this, is because we have young children who are at stake. Some of them don't even know it.
Unfortunately, this church is still going, and this church still has criminals as pastors. The church started off really good. They started off really well. They were getting ex-gang members, people who just come out of prison, and the Mariam Molas, right? Hoping to reform these young people, because London has a big problem with gangs and, you know, boys just going at it with each other. There's a huge problem there. And so when this church started, UK police were, oh, so this is something. They got on it. They got on, you know, they were keen to, you know, work with this church because they thought that the church could do something. They thought that the church would be the solution to the huge problem they had. Because what was happening was, on a Sunday, people would go, these young people would go to church. They will hear things in church, like the word of God or whatever they called it, this in the church. And then these young people would be called on to drop their weapons. These young people would drop weapons in the church to come forward. They'll drop their knives, drop their guns. And, you know, and after the service is done, Pastor Toby and his people will take these knives and guns to the police and say, look, this is what people left behind. So, you know, they started off really well until they found out that these young people were being fleeced. These young people at one point were told to bleed for seed, to go and donate blood for money to give to the church. The pastors of this church would drive in their Bentleys and their G-Wagons to secondary school to go and recruit youngsters, 13, 14, 15-year-olds, telling them, oh, come to our church. You know, you can have all of this. It's crazy. 13-year-olds. They were recruiting 13, 14-year-olds. If I was her child, I'd demand my baby prison time get deducted in case of future conviction. Right, okay, let's carry on.
But some of them probably regret what's going on. We have people on my channel commenting on the related videos saying that they've also been a part of taking out loans. How can you help me, please? Shouting for help, asking for help, because they've been in these predicaments.
Okay, so...
so this situation...
Okay, so that's Murad Morelli, lovely guy on YouTube. I follow him. He's adorable. So another video we're going to see quickly. Let's see here. Me and my clicky mouse. Right, here we go.
SPAC Nation is an evangelical church in London. They focus on saving and serving at-risk youth in the community. And by that, we mean scamming and lying to at-risk youth. Crooked pastors such as Mariam Mbula and founder Toby Adegboyega have been at the center of controversy since the church's inception. But still, teenagers and millennials give money to them in hopes of turning their life around. The church pastors even force their
followers... Okay, I have a question. The question is this. Why is it that church people, when you show them and tell them, even provide evidence that they are being scammed, they're being fleeced, that these people who they call leaders are doing them dirty, these people will still not listen to you. They would still, they're hell-bent on being scammed. I don't understand it. Can someone explain why? Why does this happen? Why are people hell-bent on being scammed by these pastors? Okay, Brian, see you later. Got to go later. All in sundry. Okay, see you later, Brian. Good to have you here. Okay, let's carry on. My goodness, I don't know why, but
followers to sell blood for donation money. Officially named the Salvation Proclaimers Anointed Church, SPAC Nation first appeared in 2008. Created by Pastor Toby Adegboyega, the church only had 3 members in its early stages. SPAC is based in South London and is known for its direct approach to getting criminals off the streets by inviting gang members to their services and asking them to drop their weapons. Hmm. These tactics gained them the media attention needed to grow their church. SPAC continued its mission with a particular target in mind, people under 30 who lived in dangerous areas of London. SPAC became a popular community outreach program that received praise from the media and even the Metropolitan Police. SPAC operates in neighborhoods with high crime rates and a population consisting of primarily Black millennials. Their weapon exchange program got the attention of both the Conservative and Labor parties. The program asked former gang members to hand over their weapons, which SPAC pastors then gave to the London police. Mm. The church has also found creative ways to attract more people to their services. SPAC formed rap and R&B groups to perform and sing songs about salvation and Jesus. However, the leaders of those groups would soon become the loudest voices speaking out against SPAC. Before the SPAC controversy became mainstream, they grew their member base from less than 300 in 2016 to 2,000 in 2020. SPAC has taken its time to get to know its congregation and exploits the lavish lifestyles of its pastors to lure more Black millennials to their church.
Do you have a big call of God on your life?
I'm right on YouTube,
and
I haven't got premium.
Maybe God has called you to write a book.
No. God hasn't called us. No.
Conferences or start a business or ministry.
Pastors dress in expensive clothes, wear high-end jewelry, and drive fancy cars. To the public, SPAC's mission seemed well-intentioned. According to the people they've scammed, there is a lot to be discovered. The church faces many accusations of misusing funds and impersonating its members to open bank accounts on their behalf. One specific case regarding a 19-year-old woman named Lovis stands out. The girl, who was staying at one of the church's youth houses, said SPAC took out a £5,000 bank loan in her name without her even knowing about it. SPAC used the £5,000 to create a company on her behalf, from which they transferred the money to a different set of companies owned by SPAC pastors. When she confronted the pastors, they told her it was for the greater good and that the money will buy a bigger youth house. Of course, as expected, Lovis would have to deal with the loan payments herself, which added up to £10,000. Sadly, nobody knows what happened to the money afterward. As if it weren't enough, some people have even come forward saying they were forced to take out a universal credit, a type of welfare in the UK, only to get half the money. There have been reports of sign-up days in which up to 50 young people would sign up to get the government benefit. Once approved, SPAC would take half the money. They targeted vulnerable young people to gain their trust before asking them for ridiculous amounts of money. If the person said they wouldn't be able to get that money, the church would suggest a bank loan. Pastor Samuel Akokia asked a young man to take out a £20,000 loan to fund an investment opportunity.
Okay, so this church, they call themselves a church, but then claim that they have several businesses that they run as well as church. They want it to be a self-funding and self, like a community that raises its own money, feeds its community, and, you know, all that money is from in there. But unfortunately, these are young people. A pastor is telling one of the young members of this church, to get £20,000. Not just that person. So many that went to this church were asked to go and get loans. So many young people were put in debt just by attending this church. When your church is the one that is causing you to be in so much debt, and unfortunately, that isn't church. That's hell. Hell on earth. Some churches are hell on earth. It's crazy, crazy, crazy.
When the man became suspicious and asked for proof, Akukia became angry and asked if he was doubting a man of God. Pastors and high leaders within the church would pressure their followers to fork over more money. When it didn't work, SPAC just took the money anyway. They had all of the bank information they needed to apply for loans in their followers' names. One young man left the church after he was scammed out of £2,000, but then received a letter in the mail saying he'd been accepted for a £5,000 loan. The biggest project funded by SPAC was their trap houses. Mm. As confusing as the name may be, trap homes were meant to save young gang members from violence in the streets. Trap stood for Take Risks and Prosper, a way to change the narratives and lives of at-risk SPAC members. In these houses, young people lived close to pastors in the church to keep them away from crime. The media reported on the project and praised how it allowed young black people to get out of gangs and violence. Many of the kids even said they would be dead if it weren't for the trap house. Members of the British Parliament called these houses a holistic solution to the rise of fatal knife crimes in London. But the stories coming out of these houses were far from a fairy tale. Reports of mistreatment within the houses surfaced, with a specific case of a 16-year-old girl stating she was mistreated in one of the trap houses. Another incident where a young boy said he had been whipped with a belt while a pastor recited some Bible verses was quickly dismissed by the church as a joke. One trap house was run by Mariam Mbula, the queen bee of SPAC scams.
There we go. She
ran her trap house strictly and pressured young women into handing over all their personal and financial information. She said she'd be managing their accounts and asked them to take out £5,000 loans.
So an ex-convict with 27 criminal convictions now is in charge of these young ladies and is telling them, you go to work, you bring your money, and I'll help manage your money. An ex-convict wants to manage the monies of the other people, and she wasn't working. She was in charge of the home. While the girls went out to work, she was the madam of this home. But somehow she will help them manage their money. Ex-con.
Keep the church's mission going. Given the negative attention the trap houses were receiving, SPAC Nation quickly, publicly distanced itself from the project, saying they were independently run houses. However, they were clearly promoting them as SPAC safe houses all over social media. One of the most notorious pastors within SPAC Nation is Mariam Mbula, known also as Mariam Mola, among other aliases. Mbula has a laundry list of fraud convictions in the UK, Spain, and Belgium. She had been busted while running a gang of thieves targeting luxury fashion brands all over Europe. By age 26, she had already been to jail 5 separate times. If Mbula is known for something other than her convictions, it's the way she's chosen to share her life story on social media. During her last stint in prison, she was 8 months pregnant. Forced to give birth in jail, she used the story to advertise a healed persona, making it seem like she'd turned her life around. Her story was even featured on some of the UK's most watched talk shows. She decided to become a mentor for women, using her embellished life story to create yet another fraudulent business. Mentor Matcher. People saw her as a philanthropist. Really, she used her way with words to persuade women into investing in her company, scamming more people along the way. Some victims claim she took between £77,000 to £100,000. Many women opened up about being scammed by Mbula. Her response was to stay quiet. It's clear she has become an expert in laying low and resurfacing with a whole new personality, which is what she did with SPAC Nation. She reappeared as an ordained minister of the church and started preaching the prosperity gospel, using her life story as the main attraction. As expected, Mbula didn't change that much. This time, she used the structure SPAC was providing to profit from vulnerable women. Many of her victims said they were impressed when they first met her, given her lavish lifestyle that included expensive clothes and dinners at top-notch restaurants.
Don't let these expensive things fool you. This lady was a real scammer through and through. She was just anyone she meets just to scam you. Off to the next. Scam this one, off to the next. So anyone who meets her for the first time, you see her in her nice designer clothes, looking so nice, you think that, oh gosh, she must be rich. She must know what she's doing. And I guess that's what she did when she went to the church. Maybe the church didn't know better themselves. But when they did find out, why didn't they stop her? Why did the church allow her to scam so many young people? And the governor and the police did really nothing. Nothing. Just nothing.
Once in London, she targeted young, vulnerable women with good credit scores or who had not taken out loans in the past. Then she forced them to get money and give it to her. Since most of the girls were staying in her safe house, Mariam had control over them.
Indeed.
Along with high leaders from SPAC Nation, she used their power to force young people into doing whatever they could to give them more money. To top it off, she never kept up with loan payments, letting the brunt of the money fall on her victims. While she was off partying and living in luxury, the at-risk millennials she was supposed to be helping were left to handle the banks.
Surprises are great.
Sorry.
Parties,
yes.
But for your work's digital security, not so much.
SPAC Nation has become a clever organization when it comes to luring young people into its ranks. And Mbula isn't the only one doing it. Knowing how gullible a young person from an impoverished background can be, SPAC pastors created novelty schemes to secure more fraudulent loans. On one occasion, 28-year-old Toy, a churchgoer, was pressured by her pastor, George Jumbo, to get a £5,000 loan. She had only met him a few months prior. He even sent her a video waving a large wad of cash stemming from his successful crypto trading business. Toy, trusting his guidance and decided to invest in his business using money from multiple loans, even allowing him to apply for a loan on her behalf. At the time, the loans fell through, but she'd already handed over all of her personal information to Jumbo. Then, 2 years later, she received letters stating she'd been approved for a loan she knew nothing about. The letters and loans kept coming in. Soon, Jumbo had acquired more than £10,000 of loans in her name. Another scheme included signing up for Universal Credit. SPAC used their trap houses as the scene for large-scale signups. They had an actual Universal Credit representative take applications and formed a line of about 50 young people to enlist in the government program. They would hand over their passports and IDs and were told their names would not appear in the official data. So it would look like they hadn't even been enrolled. Some members found themselves in £1,000 worth of debt, even when they were told they wouldn't have to pay anything. SPAC members would even use WhatsApp and Snapchat to pressure victims into taking loans as soon as possible. But this wasn't enough for SPAC Nation. Apparently, the church went as far as asking youngsters to donate blood for medical trials. SPAC members were paid £100 to donate blood for medical trials, which they'd turn around and hand over to their pastors. Known as bleeding for seed, the church can...
Guys, yes. Some of these people were told to bleed for seed. Oh my goodness. Bleeding for seed. You go and donate blood. Get money and bring to church. Why can God not provide his own money? Why can God not provide his own money for his own church? Why does he... God always needs money. Why? Why is this? Why can God not just magically make money appear? Just something. Now we want people to go and bleed for seed. BDA Carnivores 8, hello, good to see you. Bleeding for seed now.
Considered the blood money a donation offering from its members. Mbula, one of the pastors in charge of the scheme, pressured youngsters via WhatsApp, actively asking them for their
seed.
As the public became more aware of SPAC Nation's tactics, a group of victims banded together to raise their voices over the injustices they went through in the church. Let the Youngsters Go is a group of former churchgoers and workers who claim that SPAC preachers exploited them for money. They actively campaigned for young SPAC members to be set free from the church and any wrongful debt acquired while a member. One of the group's members, Takei Mad Max Mukuna, who had joined SPAC back in 2018 and remained there for 10 months, fronts the church's rap group and feels responsible for so many people getting involved with it. When in church, Mukuna says he started having disagreements with Pastor Toby about his lyrics. He wanted to leave, but felt pressured to stay. Now he sees a lot of people coming out of the church and speaking up against it. On one occasion, there was a public clash between the group and SPAC members, which had to be dismantled by the police, effectively protecting SPAC from the attack. Their financial schemes were pretty blunt. Put a lot of emphasis on donation, forcing people to donate seed money if they wanted to continue to come to their services.
Seed
a significant
money.
Part of their service revolved around cash, getting it, motivating others to give it, and investing it. Some victims felt they were pressured to give the church money, and because of the prosperity preachings, they thought they'd get their money back tenfold.
Mm-hmm.
At one point, Pastor Toby was reported to asking specific amounts of money through an entry fee. There would be an envelope that asked for
entry
a £200 minimum donation.
Oh.
While there have been several allegations of frauds.
Now, that's what the pastor uses the money for. This is the pastor of this church, and this is what he uses the money for, to live this lifestyle, to wear designer clothes, to live in a lavish home, drive fancy cars. All on the backs of these youngsters. And he uses his pastors to do his dirty work. This man.
Mm-mm-mm. Since 2019, it wasn't until 2020 that the Metropolitan Police started investigating SPAC Nation. According to the media, there are at least 20 active cases that authorities are looking into. SPAC Nation has denied these allegations, saying they have a robust system to handle all their complaints and that they would not respond to any of the individual claims about their pastors. According to SPAC, they cannot monitor what each pastor or leader
absolutely.
Does. As of 2020, Pastor Toby has stepped down from the newly named Annexation Church. He was replaced by pastors Damie Balogun and Samuel Akokia, who've racked up numerous fraud claims against them. While Pastor Toby published a press release saying he was leaving, it was unclear whether he was honest about it because he said he would still be leading the church publicly. On top of this, two people involved with the church have been arrested on fraud allegations presented in early 2020. Police claim these charges are targeted at the pastors, not the organization. As for Mariam Mbula, she's still free, although she is part of the...
Okay, so, guys, rumors recently started circulating that Mariam Mbula is pregnant and the father of the baby is Pastor Toby. It's only a rumor. I don't know how true this is. There were videos, you know, people were making videos to say Pastor Toby is the father of this. Pastor Toby is married. He's married with his own family, but I don't know. I couldn't possibly tell you. So now let's watch Mariam Mola in her while she does her thing. Mm-hmm. Here we go.
Monster giver. I'm a queen. They're gonna write Phoebe. Monster giver.
Monster giver.
On our grave, they're gonna say monster sower. Therese, are you crazy? She'll be standing there doing periscope for Pastor Obi when he's preaching, but her mind is thinking seed. Her mind is thinking seed. Her mind is thinking giving. Her mind is thinking giving. A Victoria who is new to a SPAC Nation, a goodness who nobody knows, but she comes on a prayer line and she's just firing off. But she's thinking seed. What are you talking about?
Mm-hmm.
A Sarah Alates. Let me tell you guys something about Sarah Alates here. This girl, her first seed was four figures.
Seed. Four figures.
Sarah, this is what you're going to give. She said, yes, ma'am. So when she's telling you that she's my daughter, it's not because she shouts like me. Because let me tell you something now. We can all, look, the boys even know how to do a pastor backing voice. That doesn't mean that they're pastor backing. That's the truth. It doesn't mean because Sarah shouts like me, she's me. She sews like me.
So
you're going to sell your entire student finance. I don't care if I'm online. What are you doing with that money? As a young person, you cannot have all of that money and sit on that money. Who are you? When there is another young person in need.
As a young person, you cannot have all of that money and sit on that money. Who are you? It's your money, but you cannot just sit on the money. Because there are other people in need. So these youngsters are made to give up their... Can you imagine listening to this? Incredible story. Great stream as always. I have to finish watching. All right, Theo. Theo, not to worry. I know this is an early stream because I've got another meeting in a bit. So I might come back later on, okay? So guys, I might come back later. This is just the... really quick stream. I've got a meeting shortly, so I shall be back later on. But we will finish this one.
You're going to go and sell that money, and you're going to go and find more money, and you're going to put it in the ground. That is what qualifies you to be a daughter. A daughter is somebody who has the same issues as their parent. You carry the same issues. You are not a daughter of nobody if you don't have the same genes. Let Pastor Evan tell you. We are daughters of a Pastor Toby because we share the same burden. What is the burden? It's souls. Maybe your landlady is not pushing you to sow. You wasn't a sower. You wasn't a sower. But as of Phoebe, not only is she sowing for herself, but she's 3G. She's basically bought 3G. All those people in the choir, but sending them seed. She said, I'm bleeding to feed. I'm even shaking. Pastor Alex, stop texting.
Bleeding to feed.
Send me bread.
Well, that is Mariam Mola in her element. Well, guys, that is just 1 second. Let me. The next video that came up, I think I might do a video on this. A 9-year-old girl was shot dead in her home in Liverpool, UK. The events that caused this young girl to lose her life is so shocking. Gun crime is starting to rise in the UK. Gun and knife crime, they're starting to rise. And 9-year-old died, I think just a few days ago now, in Liverpool. So I think I'll do a video on this. It's just absolutely shocking. Just 1 second, let me get my next video. Okay, here we go. Let me play this one. All right, let me share this in.
That I cannot get my hands on. And there is a way that, look, guys, let me tell you something here. There is no amount of money in this world. Listen to me. I believe this thing so much so. That's probably why I'm probably not very much there. Because I believe this thing so much. There is no amount of money that PT is going to call that I cannot.
So you're hearing her. She's not 100% there. Because there's no amount of money there Pastor Toby will call that she will not go out and get. whatever money Pastor Toby says we need to go rent our expensive hotel room for our next service, for Pastor Toby to buy his next expensive car, whatever Pastor Toby needs money for, his everly reliant pastress. Jesus, I'm on it. I will get that money for you because I am loyal to you.
Not get my hands on. And I'll say this to you guys, it's better for me to not exist. And I'll, okay, it's better for me to die than to think that I can't get that money. And I'll say this, I don't care how I get it. I just know that I can get it.
Gosh, better for her to die than to get money for pastor. No, let me take that back. Jesus Christ, that's just gross.
Okay, it's better for me to die than to think that I can't get that money. And I'll say this, I don't care how I get it. I just know that I can get it. And even if I don't get it, it will come through. God will show me who has the money. I was speaking to Pastor Arthur this week. I said, I need 7 people that can give me 1K every week. I don't want you paying for services anymore. I'm going to find those. And I said, is that okay? Because I know that you were paying for services before. I don't want you paying for services anymore. I can't rely on one person to give me money for services. I don't even need that. I just need to raise new finances. And I said, God, begin to show me the faces of these people. Mm. And one by one, I started to see who they were. When I called them, they were elated. They were like, huh? Ma, like, I've been waiting. Da-da-da-da-da. How?
Guys, one last video and we'll be done. Oh, yeah. Absolutely crazy. 1 second. Okay. Let's see. Hang on. Stop. Okay. Let me share this here. 1 second. And be done. Bleeding for seed. Here we go.
Guys, I've seen your messages regarding this video, and I will be doing a full analysis of this video tomorrow.
So did you guys hear that? She doesn't know God, but she knows pastor. She does not know God, but she knows. She doesn't know her God, but she knows pastor.
They were not looking for the presence of God, bro. They were not looking for the presence of God. Who's that? I tell you guys every day, I don't know who God is. If I make it in heaven, yeah. But for now, I don't know who that person is. I just know PT. So I got to now find out that Mariam, listen, this man has invested so much time in your world, finding out how you are, what's going on. It's now time for a mindset to shift. And you now need to enter his world and enter in the presence of a PT.
Yes, guys, I've seen your messages regarding this video. And I will be doing a full analysis of this video tomorrow. This needs to be stopped. This woman has become uncontrollable.
Well, unfortunately, she is still at this church, still allowed to carry on scamming people. But hey, I think we just need to keep on speaking. Just calling these things out, and you know, so absolutely crazy. So guys, I will see you all later on. I'll be back later, okay? back later, and yeah, enjoy the rest of your afternoon, evening, whatever your whatever time it is where you are. I will see you all later on. So right here we go. Sir Little Wolf, hello, I'll see you all later. Right, let's see, let me share this here.
Do you have a moment? And this very second, I know you feel the beat. Do you feel the rhythm?
Can you even say, I'll be in touch? Hang on. Can you even say, I'll be in touch with you? We need to, we will talk. So I will be in touch with you on Discord.
Can you see the vision? Everything in this world will be okay. Can we be together all the way? I know you feel this movement right here. You just be vibing, reaching for something within you. I know you feel this movement right here. You just be vibing, reaching for something within you. Nights in California fly, passing homes, yeah, right by sunset colored skies. Chilling by the ocean, dropping up the mountain, soaked in the endless beauty all of you. You know it feels alright, alright.